Very happy to introduce our next speaker, Mr. Ujjwal Chakraborty from KIMS Trivandrum, who is the AGM of CSSD for KIMS Trivandrum. He is not only known as a personal teacher and a friend to me, but he's an excellent human being by himself. He has many hats and many things that he has been doing for the last few years, not only in CSSD, but in hospital management and in training and in other areas that is there. He has over 17 years of experience in CSSD. He has delivered talks all across India in both national and international conferences. He has been one of the few selected few who has been selected for the Chairman Circle Award from CK Birla for leadership development as a high performance individual. He has also developed the 3M Kaho modules. His CSSD earlier was awarded as the second best CSSD in India. He is also one of the few people who is an initial member in India and has completed his CRCST certification. And it's my privilege to introduce Ujjwal to our wonderful speakers, participants today. Over to you, Ujjwal. Thank you so much for joining.
Welcome all. Thanks a lot, Kaho and Ashqua, for giving me an opportunity. And whatever today I'll be discussing, all will be based on evidence-based, and these are the references. And today my topic is sterilization methods and indicators. So if I go by this, now these are different sterilization methods. I have not gone into very deep detail like burning, flaming, and all other activities. So these are the main sterilization methods that we generally use in our CSSDs of the hospital. And for the time constraints, I will be discussing only about physical and chemical, these two processes of sterilization method. So if you see that these are very basic slides, and we all must know this, that if you talk about dry heat and if you talk about moist heat, dry heat requires much more longer time for sterilization, and moist heat requires very minimal time. The reason behind is aqueous. So if you talk about moist heat, there are actually different kinds of sterilizers, starting from gravity, and mainly we divide into two types, gravity and pre-vacuum. Now, when you talk about pre-vacuum, pre-vacuums are having many different kinds of sterilizers in terms of vacuuming. Sometimes it is positive pulsing, sometimes it is negative pulsing. So all those things are there in pre-vacuum. And for gravity sterilizers, it's only just the top side down, means the steam comes or steam enters in the chamber from the trough, and there is a drain valve, and all the air inside the chamber generally pass on from this drain valve. And we need to be very careful, because in my different experience and different visits of hospitals across country, I have seen that some of the hospitals who are having gravity type sterilizers, they are still using Boydic test. So please be very careful. Boydic test is not some test which should be done in gravity type. It should always be done in pre-vacuum, because we are trying to measure the air elimination part, right? And when we talk about the dry heat sterilizers are because of this heavy exposure time, long exposure time and heavy temperature. Generally, in most of the CSSDs, we generally don't have dry heat sterilizer, but yes, if we need to sterilize bulk powder or some oil, we do need dry heat sterilizers. So now when we talk about chemical sterilization, in chemical sterilization, we are having mainly three different types of sterilization. One is ethylene oxide, formaldehyde, and hydrogen peroxide. So these all I am saying as an automated sterilization process. Some may also tell that there are some sporicidal disinfectants that can also be treated as a sterilization method, but I am not talking about all those sporicidal disinfectants. I am talking about some equipment wherein we are using this kind of chemicals for the sterilization purpose. And if you see that ethylene oxide, it is having generally two different temperature window, one is 37, one is 55. And if you talk about hydrogen peroxide, it generally runs in a temperature between 37 to 45. But if you really see the turnaround time is much more quicker in hydrogen peroxide, wherein you can see that between 25 to 75 minutes, we can actually complete a full cycle. So when we are saying about this ethylene oxide, hydrogen peroxide, then we are also having steam formaldehyde. Now we must have seen that there are different kinds of formalin chamber we generally using for sterilizing our heat sensitive or quick turnaround time instruments, wherein we keep some formalin tablets in the formalin chamber and we are just thinking that it is getting sterilized. Plus, please, I would like to draw your kind attention that please see that if you want to do a formal right sterilization, the minimum RH factor that we are looking for is 75 to 100%. Now, if we are not having this many relative humidity, then our sterilization or our end product is not getting sterilized. So that's the part. So if you see that these three different kinds of sterilizations, then we can definitely understand that what are the different advantages and disadvantages of a sterilization process. Now, if you see steam sterilization, generally it is told or it is circulated that it is the cheapest. Now, here I sometimes disagree, because if you are working in a hospital wherein your normal TDS is more than 2000 ppm, then the processing of water is not that cheapest. So sometimes it is not that cheap. So sometimes steam sterilization is also very costly. So depending upon the raw water that we are getting. Now, if you see the disadvantage, steam sterilizer is only having the disadvantage of heat resistant material. So predominantly, if we talk about different sterilization process, actually the main difference is about material compatibility. So if the materials are not compatible, we cannot refer that in the particular sterilization process. Now, if you see the gas sterilization, it is having good penetrability, it is having good material compatibility. But if you really talk that I need to have at least 4 or 5 laparoscopic surgeries in a day, wherein I am having only one set of instrument, it is very difficult for me to generate this kind of sterilized instrument. But same point, if I need to sterilize long cardiac catheters wherein we need good penetration and good material compatibility, then definitely we do require gas sterilization. So it's not that if you see that even in plasma, if you talk about plasma is very good at timer and turnaround time, and we can have very good sterilization efficacy in terms of powered surgical instruments and complex surgeries. And earlier, one of the speakers have rightly told that if we are doing some robotics, we definitely need for quick turnaround time, you definitely need some quick solution. So having all this said and done, if you see the next slide, there are sometimes this kind of questions I do face, which is the best sterilizer? Now, which is the best sterilizer or which is the best sterilization process? The only answer is that these are different sterilization methods and the usage is different. So hence, we have to select the proper method of sterilization as per the type of product to be sterilized and other critical factors. So here I would like to focus only 2 more minutes time that if we are not putting so much pressure at the time of planning, so what happens? Training a doctor may be very easy, maybe 5 years, maybe 5.5 years, maybe 10 years they are training. They are building an OT, they are doing all kinds of costly equipment investment. But when it comes to CSSD, everybody says there is a question that can we do like this, can we do like that? So only question I would like to give it to the very august audience is that, can we live without oxygen? So that is the question I would like to put forward. Can we really live without oxygen? So if we cannot live without oxygen, then why this kind of makeshift arrangements and this cutting corners we are discussing when it comes to CSSD, maybe we need to all think about. And I am really grateful for CAHO and NABH and ASHQA that they are taking this topic and they're trying to make it a daily affair wherein sterilization and disinfection gets also the limelight, so that we can at the end of the day deliver quality in all deliveries, not just sterile supply. So when you talk about indicators, this is only one slide. You can see that everything is jumbled here. And the thing is that it's really required all of our sterilizers should give us automatic printout. Now, if you see that these are really high-end screens that we can see, which are microprocessor controlled autoclaves. But please remember, in different parts of remote areas, we may not have this kind of autoclaves, right? So please try to have a proper documentation system, because there is a saying that in God we trust, rest all must bring data. So please try to prepare your data, try to have data in place. If you are working in CSSD, even if the sterilizer is not giving printout, try to make it manually and try to go and reach to management to convince them so that they can at least put some effort so that we can have an automatic printed system from the sterilizer so that most of our job is over. Now, if you talk about indicators, there are different indicators starting from type 1 to type 6. And if you talk about somebody, I have seen also ask a question related to who you on his best. So I think Dr. Shashank has rightly answered the thing. I am not repeating that fact. And if you talk about this biological indicator, so I think there is a typographical error. These are not chemical indicators. These are called biological indicators, wherein you can see that different color codes are there. So we must have seen all these things, all biological indicators, but only point to focus is here that you need to know that D value. What is D value? We must all be knowing that D value is the decimal reduction time, means in a certain time, what kind of one log or 90% of population, how much time it takes to reduce. So if we know the D value of the biological indicators, so what I am saying in my previous slide, that all has to be evidence-based. You need to know the D value. You need to be very careful, because where from you can know the D value? Because if you see these boxes, when you open the box, all the product inserts are inside the box. And most of the time, what do? Because every time we are getting new boxes and we are just throwing these product inserts and throwing it to the dustbin, we don't even bother to see it. So the information is all around. Google is there, Kaho is there. So please try to reach out to strengthen your product and to strengthen your technical knowledge, so that day comes wherein we really accept that we need oxygen to live. And quality initiatives, what is my point is that is one day activity to pass the audit or need to be a daily habit. We need to ask these questions to ourselves. With that note, thanks a lot for giving me this opportunity to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Ujwal, for as usual, a very wonderful and a crisp talk. How do we maintain records and track reprocessed instruments? So it talks about documentation and tracking. Could you just throw a quick light on that?
Yeah, so when you talk about reprocessing of instruments, as I told that we need to do the documentation. So you need to just prepare your document. So when you talk about reprocessing instruments, if I have understood clearly, you are saying the reusable items, not the single use devices, right? So yes. If it is a reusable items, you just need to maintain a log wherein you can write date, name of the instrument or name of the set, the quantity, and the different kinds of load indicators that you are having, pass or fail. And so that you, if there is a space, you can also affix the chemical indicator. So this is about your reusable instruments. But if you talk about single-use devices, if you go through the FDA or even if you go through the NABH guidelines, so actually CSSD's job becomes very, very difficult, because wherein you are saying on one point that you need to have a general consent from the patient saying that we are going, during your course of treatment, you may go into a reusing of single use devices. And for that, actually, what is the JCI or FDA requirement is you need to clean. You should have the capacity to clean the item. You should have the capacity to mark the item. You should have the capacity to tell that fifth time of usage, it was which patient or it was which patient ID. So all this kind of detailing you need to do. Now, what we have done in some of the hospitals is that we need to give some kind of unique identification number on different products, but the point fails when it is a ware or when it is a very tiny item wherein you cannot write. So in that situation, what do? We generally give a unique codification on the packet, and we tell the users when you are sending the material, you also need to send back the packet so that we can track and trace and document. So it's a very Herculean task actually, because if you see even our HIS or hospital information system is most of the hospitals, it is not even stabilized till date. And when we are talking about tracking of CSSD instruments or items, we are really struggling hard to get some kind of solutions if you talk about software interventions.
Okay, Great. Okay, just a quick question. I know this was not a topic that was there, but how do we do a recall procedure if there's a breakdown of sterilization system which is identified?
Yes. So please, I would like to request Kaho and even the member of NABH also that I think this recall is misunderstood throughout the country. I am giving an example. So I'm giving an example. Suppose we have purchased a mobile phone from brand X company, right? Now, if 50 of us have purchased the same brand, and if I am facing a problem with my mobile phone when I am going for the service center, is it a recall or is it a reprocess? So it's called as reprocess or warranty coverage we are going, right? But when a company initiates that in that particular X model, we are having a problem with the battery, please give us all those models. We would like to change the battery. Then is the time which is called as recall. So why I'm saying this is misunderstood throughout the country, because whenever an user is getting any damaged pack or expiry pack or torn pack, when they're sending that item to the CSS, did they call it as a recall? Recall can only be initiated by the manufacturer. Recall cannot be initiated by any other. So whatever they will be sending, those has to be treated as reprocess, not the recall. That is one. Second, when you are talking about recall, it's very easy. When you are saying sterilization is a failure, doctor has rightly told that 2008 is the year when CDC has come up with very comprehensive document, wherein CDC also tells that only one failure result of your steam sterilizer doesn't tell you that your steam sterilization process is faulty. There is no need to recall all the items if you get only one steam sterilization failure. But the problem is in our countries, we generally use biological indicator once in a week maybe. So if you are using once in a week, recall or taking back all those items is actually a Herculean, and it gives no sense, because by that time it must have been used onto the patients or must have been used onto the other activities. So please remember that when we talk about recall, if there is a sterilization failure, if we are doing only once a week a recall system, we need to call back all the items till the time wherein we last got the satisfactory result from the BI. Let me give you simplify this. Suppose you have done Monday as a negative BI. Now, next Monday, you are getting a positive BI. That means from Monday, that negative BI load, after that load to till this Monday's, whatever load you have sterilized, each and every item you are supposed to recall. So now you can understand what kind of Herculean task it will be if you are not using at least daily. Management, and ask for resources and ask for more things about CSSD.
Okay, excellent. So as we said, yeah, daily monitoring and every load monitoring is definitely important to ensure your recall or reprocess thing in process. So this is a quick question. This is, what is the ideal time for pre-vacuum sterilization at 134 degrees? Basically, they're asking about the sterilization hold time.
So sterilization hold time, ideal time is 4 minutes, 04. That is 4 minutes. That's why you are getting your voidic test as 3.5 minutes. So ideal time of your sterilization is 4 minutes. There is no need, if you are not having prions, there is no need to give extended time.
Okay. So are there any water standards for steam sterilization, the water that is used for
Definitely. EN285 categorically tells what kind of water parameters are required. So it is really available. If anybody is interested, I can definitely mail them.
So would we say a good quality RO water should be a good starting point?
Yeah. So when we are saying good quality RO water, again, it's a very wide range of term, because RO water, what water we are taking in our house for drinking purpose, that is also RO. And RO water that is required in dialysis, that is also RO. RO water we require in disinfection process, that is also RO. So parameter differentiates. So definitely we require RO water with the prefixed parameters, what is already defined by EN285.
Okay. And just to ask, repeat the question again, should biological indicators be used daily? So I'm just sorry, for benefit of others.
So all depends. Please ask, do we really require oxygen to live? So if the answer is yes, try to motivate yourself. If you are motivated, then only you can reach out to the management. Then only you can ask, because management is very eager to lay granite stones from Italy or from XYZ in their main lobby. But when you are even some Da Vinci robot XYZ, this kind of different things, when it comes to CSSD, do we really require sterilizer sometimes? They may also ask. So please reach out to management. If you can have your legitimate logic and legitimate demand, there are managements, there are people who will actually support and who will actually handhold you. Because in these many years of my service, and not only in only one organization, I have been to different organizations. So if you can reach out, because management, you also should understand that they are bogged down with so many other issues. They are not only looking after CSSD. So it is you who need to be motivated and who need to be accessible to the management to ask and to spread out whatever you require to run their CSSD and to run controlled infection in their facility.
Yes, thank you.